Thank you, President. Thank you, President Flagg, for inviting me. In fact, Bill actually came to my office in Washington, D.C. You know, he's been all untiringly just, you know, meeting with every important people in Washington. I know he's been working with, you know, Fannie and other GSE in the past, and then with various, not only with NAR, but with NIRAP and other organizations to try to get the diversity aspect of the real estate. So untiring President Bill Flagg in his work. And he came by my office and said, hey, can you do a session for Northern Jersey Central area? And I said, oh yeah, sure. Yeah. So I'm happy to join you all. As Bill mentioned, I do have a hard stop at 11 o'clock, and this is just to unexpected scheduling where I just got a call from NBC News, the one with Lester Holt, where they want to do some housing market news tonight, because it was actually terrible news that came out this morning, which is from us, to say that pending contract sank to their lowest level in 2010. And you are feeling it out there because higher mortgage rate is really shrinking the buyer pool. In fact, your clients of the past couple of years, if you think about it, they would not be homeowners if the mortgage rates were 7%. Thank goodness they got into the market when the mortgage rates were at 3%. And furthermore, they got some price appreciation since they became homeowners, so wealth built up. But the market has completely changed, transitioned, much higher mortgage rate, shrinking the buyer pool. Another bad news is that the new listings are not popping out. So yes, you are just hunting for fresh listings, new listings are not popping out because the builders are becoming very cautious, cutting back on some construction. At the same time, homeowners who thought they would want to trade up suddenly say, look, I have an additional child in the family. I'm happy with the child. We need that extra bedroom. And then they said, well, hold on a second. I love my 3% mortgage rate more than the extra bedroom. So they're staying put. And consequently, we are not even getting this seller. Very, very tough market out there. So in this brief time, let me try to put as much information I can. And I will share the PowerPoint slide with you all to be distributed so you can look at it at more leisure. But let me just scroll down quickly on what the current situation is and what you can anticipate as you go into next year. So let's first look at the mortgage rate. So this mortgage rate chart is from early 1990. So it's a long-term chart. And of course, with any financial variable, it goes up, it goes down. And generally speaking, it's been trending down from 1990 all the way until the beginning of this year. This year, everything changed, but it was trending down generally speaking. And the reason why it was falling was because inflation became less of an issue. If inflation is not an issue, then what do the lenders do? Lenders say, well, I will lend you the money, and the money that you return back would have retained that value plus interest. So I am well off. So lenders are willing to lend a low interest rate, knowing that there is a buying power of that return money. But if inflation rate is high, then the lenders say, well, the money that you returned to me has lost value. It lost purchasing power. There's no way I can make the numbers work other than by raising interest rate to compensate for inflation. So in a sense, you are saying that mortgage rate have declined over the past three decades, but this year is turning up because inflation is getting out of control. An indirect mechanism, which we all know, Federal Reserve is raising interest rate, their short-term interest rate, the mortgage-backed security market is impacted. So all that filtering impact is what you see right now in the marketplace and what your clients are facing. But in essence, low inflation, low mortgage rates, high inflation, high mortgage rate condition. I put that the little three red bar to indicate something called resistance point. Now in Northern Central New Jersey, you have many people who goes to Manhattan, work in the Wall Street. And they will explain, in Wall Street, there's all this technology terminology. including something called resistance point. And what a resistance point is, in essence, it's like a wall. So financial market variable move up and down, but once it hits the wall, it tends to retract back down again. So that's what generally happens. Unless the wall is broken, if the wall is punctured and broken, then it makes a huge gain until the next resistance point, next wall. So what you see here is that the first red bar, which is, I guess, the lower bar that you see, that's the resistance point. And this year, the mortgage rate just burst through that as if nothing existed. But we are now at the second resistance point. Second resistance point, a mortgage rate of 7%, critical juncture, because if this wall is broken, then the third resistance point, one is looking at 8.5% mortgage rate, something that we definitely do not want to see. So it is a battle right now to see whether the resistance will hold. It's just a trader's momentum, buyers, sellers, you know, trading bonds, mortgage-backed securities, trying to determine whether the wall would hold. And if it holds, it is possible that mortgage rate may retreat to 6.5% before trying to go back up to 7%. So that is possible condition, but right now at a critical juncture. First thing that I do every morning is look at the 10-year treasury yield, which is the blue line. The red line is the mortgage rate. This is a long time period from 1970. As you can see, two lines almost move in a synchronized fashion, up, down, very, very synchronized fashion. So by looking at the 10-year treasury yield, which is what the US government would pay in interest to borrow money, and the US government is running a deficit, so they have to borrow money, and the interest rate they pay is roughly the 10-year treasury yield. So the mortgage rate, for the most part, it has the government backing. Unlike many other countries in America, we do have the government backing on mortgages, which is the reason that it is only a little bit higher than what the government borrowing rate would be. So as a US consumer, we are very fortunate. We can borrow, generally speaking, a lower interest rate. But 10-year treasury is rising, and therefore the mortgage rate is rising. Something funny is happening nonetheless. This is the spread between 10-year treasury and 30 years. Generally speaking, the spread should be 150 basis point to 200 basis point condition. Sorry for the technological terminology. What it means is that if the government borrows at 4%, then mortgage rate should be around 6%. But the spread today is much larger than usual. So larger spread is leading to this 7% mortgage rate. Our advocacy team in Washington, we are now talking with various regulators to say, what's happening here? Why is the spread so large? Because if the spread is just back to normal, mortgage rate today would be at 6%, not 7%. So we are talking to many people here in Washington to determine why that is the case. Because certainly bringing that down will definitely help your potential buyer's condition. I put that two red circle to indicate only other time when the spread really widened was during massive panic situation. When Lehman Brothers went under back in 2009, setting off the Great Recession or 2008, the spread widened. And then when the COVID arrived to the country, that ugly COVID arrived to the country in March, the spread widened. We are not in that type of alarming panic situation today. So we don't know why the spread should be this large. So uncalled for, we are talking to people in Washington to see if we can bring the spread back down so that your potential clients can borrow at 6% rather than at 7%. But the mortgage rate is 7% today. And what we are seeing is pending contract is sinking, sinking, and sinking. The red line indicates right before COVID, we had a lockdown. So we were stuck at home, cannot do anything, pending contract collapse. But once the economy reopened, look how robust sales activity. Then this year, sinking, 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 just as mortgage rate is rising. Only when mortgage rates stabilize will pending home sales stabilize and closing sales activity stabilize. And we are not there yet. So we're hoping that resistance point hold, mortgage rate stabilize at 7, or possibly even go back. Again, either the spread or the traders, again, facing the wall now can retreat back somewhat, but it's still quite an interesting time that we are living. When I look at the local market data, using Morris County as one example, what I see in the New Jersey County is that the closed activity is down 10% in September, which is actually doing better than rest of the country. Rest of the country is down 20%. So at least in Morris County, it is down only 10%. But look at the first line. New listings, fresh listings are not popping out. And that is why there's still some multiple offers happening. So you are saying, well, buyers retreated, so maybe the supply is going up. But we don't have that much supply. So when a new listing's coming onto the neighborhood, that is the only listing available. So the few people who are still in the market, they want to grab it, there is some degree of multiple offers. So multiple offers has not disappeared. It's still happening somewhat because of lack of inventory. And just using one other example, Union County, a very similar situation. New listings are down. Close activity, down only 5% in September. Again, doing better than the rest of the country. Rest of the country is down 20% in September to September of last year. Now, this is the inventory condition nationwide, which will be very reflected of just about every place in the country. And you want to show this chart to say, today's market condition is not a housing crash conditions. Sales activities are lower, inventories are low, but the prices will not crash 30% because you look at this graph. Simple economics, supply and demand. We don't have enough supply. Look at the time when we had the foreclosure mess, and New Jersey was one of the areas with massive foreclosure 15 years ago. There was four times more inventory at that time. That's when prices crashed. Today, in a tight condition, tight inventory condition, prices simply cannot crash. Could prices decline 5%? I would say yes, but prices could equally rise 5%. I don't know which way it would go, -5 or +5, but -30, definitely not. +30, definitely not with much higher mortgage rate. So I think the prices will be sort of right near the zero level in most markets. Now, the number of foreclosed and short sales activity currently is almost non-existent. In fact, the recent figure is 2%. Last year was 1%. So some people in the media may say, oh, foreclosure, short sales went from 1% to 2%. That is doubling of the foreclosure crisis. But as you can see on the chart, it is essentially non-existent. Back in 2010, 35%, 40% of transactions were foreclosures and other distressed property sales. Let me now flip to the economy. Economy is struggling. So this is a GDP broader measure. The early portion of the chart shows the lockdown and collapse in the economy. But the reopening of the economy led to some recovery and was positive until this year. This year, it went negative for two straight quarters. Mild decline, nothing major, mild decline. I have a 5-minute warning, mild decline. But the data that came out yesterday showed a little positive. There are some one-time factor at play, so one cannot be sure what's going to happen on the next quarter. Next quarter could be negative. So we are running right at the edge of between positive and negative. Stock market, as you know, is down. You look at your retirement portfolio, certainly feels like a recession. And the job market is pretty much now fully recovered on a nationwide basis. So total number of jobs in America. But if we look at state-by-state comparison, interesting pattern develops. The green color states, they have far more jobs today versus March 20 pre-COVID. But the orange color states, they are down. New York is down, Pennsylvania is down, essentially all New England states are down except for New Jersey. New Jersey is the only positive state. I put that blue arrow to indicate plus 1.1. So something special is happening in New Jersey, and maybe that is why home sales are holding on better in New Jersey compared to other parts of the country, given the conditions. This is the total number of jobs, including the big city along with the suburbs surrounding. I think this data actually includes one county in Pennsylvania. So definitely, you know, the county near the Pennsylvania border, New Jersey, would also be included in this. But as you can see, the total number of jobs from year 2000, which was 8.5 million, now hit 10 million jobs in the local region. Then the COVID hit, so you lost jobs during COVID, trying to come back, almost back to normal, not quite, but this is including the New York City. But the New Jersey, as I mentioned, is positive. New Jersey side is positive, even though the New York side may still be trying to recover. Let me, for the simplicity, go into my very last chart. This is about inflation. Inflation is ugly, we don't like it, but if there is a one potential benefit of inflation, redistribution of wealth, is that people who are holding on to large debt benefit. So what I put is a simulation of person taking out a mortgage at today's 7% rate. Their monthly payment is 2329. Next year, same amount, next year, same amount. I'm not including property tax, just the mortgage payment. Middle column is someone who's making $80,000 a year monthly salary. But based on today's market condition, their salaries are rising 5%. Next year, it could be 5% or so. It doesn't mean their standard of living is rising. They're just trying to catch up with inflation. If you are on Social Security, next year you will get an 8% increase in your Social Security check. So when there's an inflation, at least there's some increase in income just to catch up with inflation. But look at the last column. Percent of salary dedicated to the mortgage steadily declines. So if you can qualify, and if there's an inflation, you have this table. But let's say inflation disappears 1 year from now or 2 years from now. Inflation disappears. This table is no longer relevant. But guess what happens if inflation disappears? Mortgage rate would be much lower, 5% or even 4%. And what do you do after you purchase home at 7%? You refinance. I purchased my home at 8.5%, certainly one of the best decisions ever, because I refinanced later at down lower rate. So please consider this in terms of the potential buyers who may be a little hesitant out there, because inflation is terrible. Inflation is leading to higher mortgage rates today, but consider the fact that table is showing that still buying a home means that one will overall benefit as the large debt diminishes in value over time. And the second part, if somehow inflation disappears in a couple of years, you can always refinance into lower rates. So thank you very much for inviting me to participate. And again, my good friend, President Bill Flagg, I really appreciate your invitation. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Hume. Thank you. You know, sometimes you have to play, you know, with a new playbook and a new play, and you call the audible. So Crystal has set up Jeff Dollinger to come back and do a live legal update webinar. So Jeff, please start over, Jeff, or start.
Actually, sorry about that, guys. Jeff did have to go. So we will do a live session later on. We'll put it on the calendar. So just stay tuned to ncjr.com for us to have a webinar with Jeff.
Okay, well, I guess that will conclude our meeting. I want to thank everyone for your participation today. And we look forward to seeing you in Atlantic City in Triple Play. So don't forget about our party at Harrah's at the Rum Point restaurant. And we hope to see you soon. Thank you all.